Hi, this is Dibya Prakash from incoherent.in. This is the second video of radiation detectors series, and in this video we are going to discuss about basic physics of radiation detection, where we will discuss various interactions of radiations with matter, and based on those interacting mechanisms, how different radiation detectors like GM counters, survey contamination monitors, dose calibrators, pocket dosimeters, gamma camera, PET-CT, PET-MRI, or the CT detectors, how those detectors work, that we are going to discuss in this presentation. Just as a quick recap, in the last video, which was the first of its series, we discussed about medical applications of radiation detectors, where we discussed various applications of radiation detectors in the medicine field. Kindly refer that video for more details. The link is given in the description box. So let's begin and see what is the basic principle of radiation detection. Any radiation detection system has a sensor which produces signal upon interaction with radiation, which can be processed to quantify to know the energy and the momentum. That means it is a sensor which produces signals upon interaction with the radiation, which can be processed to quantify or to know the energy and the momentum. There are some desired characteristics of a radiation detection system, which includes a good energy resolution. That means it should have ability to resolve and discriminate different radiation energies efficiently. In the second property, it should have a good counting efficiency. That means it should have ability to count radiation. And in ideal kind of conditions, a good radiation detection system should have 100% of efficiency. That means whatever radiation falls on it, it should be able to count. The formula for calculation of radiation efficiency is CPS by DPS into 100. That means counts per second divided by disintegration per second into 100. That means whatever counts coming out from this divided by the disintegration per second into 100. It should have a low inherent dead time. That means it should be able to count without being paralyzed. And in ideal condition, it should not have any dead time. These are the basic desired characteristics of a good radiation detection system. So what is radiation? Radiation is a form of energy in transit. Means there may be some emissions, there may be some transmissions of energy through space or to any medium. There are two types of radiation. One is particulate radiation and the other is electromagnetic radiation. The examples of particulate radiation is electrons, protons, neutrons, positron, and the examples of electromagnetic radiation is gamma, X-rays, UV, IR, etc. And this particulate radiation carries energy in the form of kinetic energy because they have mass with them. So they carry energy in the form of kinetic energy. And in case of electromagnetic radiations, they carry energy in oscillating electrical and magnetic fields traveling through space at the speed of light. Let's see how radiation interacts with the matter. They transfer energy when they pass through, and the principal mechanism of transfer of energy is excitation and ionization, and most of these energies ultimately degraded into the heat. And radiation detection process uses the property of energy transfer mechanism to the matter, and this mechanism differs both in particulate as well as electrical magnetic radiation. Means they have different kind of radiations, different kind of interactions when there is a particulate radiation and when there is a electromagnetic radiation. So let's see one by one. Let's see first how the particulate radiation or the charged particle radiation interacts with the matter. There are three possible kinds of interaction mechanism, which may be excitation, ionization, or the Bremsstrahlung radiation. In excitation, when the incident particle has energy which is transferred to the orbital electron, which gets the sufficient energy to go to the higher orbit, and when they come back to their original state, they release some in the form of electromagnetic radiations like UV, IR, or visible light. and this transferred energy is dissipated in molecular vibrations, atomic emissions of infrared, visible light, ultraviolet radiations, and so forth. So this condition is called as a excitation. And in case of ionization, when the charged particles have sufficient energy to dissociate its orbital electron. See, here there was an orbital electron which was knocked out from its place, and the atom or the molecule was left in the state of ionization. This electron is called as a secondary electron. And when this electron is of lower orbit, this is filled up by some higher orbit electron, and in this case some electromagnetic radiation comes out, which is called as a characteristic X-rays. Or this energy may be transferred to some higher orbit electrons, and if that higher orbit electron has sufficient energy to overcome its binding energy, then this electron will also be ejected, and that electron is called as a Auger electron. This secondary electron which comes out from the orbit is called as a delta ray. Let's see the graphical representation of characteristic X-rays and the Auger electron. See, this is the incident particle which knocks out the orbital electron. This is the secondary electron. There is a vacancy is created in K shell. This may be filled up by L shell electron or the M shell electron. During this process, there is a change in energy state of electrons. Means the electron from the higher energy state to the lower energy state they are coming. So during this change of energy, they have some excess energy which will be released in the form of electromagnetic radiation or in the form of X-rays which are characteristic to that particular atom. That is why they are called as a characteristic X-rays. In case of Auger electron, this excess energy is transferred to the outer shell electron. And if this electron has sufficient energy to overcome its binding energy, this will come out of the atom, and this electron will be called as a Auger electron. And the third condition is called as a Bremsstrahlung radiation. We have discussed excitation, we have discussed ionization, and now let's discuss Bremsstrahlung. In excitation and ionization, we said the incident particle interacts with the orbital electron, but in Bremsstrahlung radiation the incident particle interacts with the nucleus of the atom. Suppose there is a charged particle, for example let's take an electron which is a negatively charged particle that incidents on the atom, and since the nucleus has a positive charge, they get attracted towards this and their energy gets decelerated, and this energy of deceleration is released in the form of electromagnetic radiation, which is called as a Bremsstrahlung radiation or breaking radiation. Bremsstrahlung is a German word which is a combination of Bremsen plus Strahlung. Bremsen means breaking and Strahlung means radiation, and this radiation is a continuous X-rays. So we discussed ionization, we discussed excitation, and we discussed Bremsstrahlung. These are the three possible interactions of charged particles with the matter. Now let's discuss interactions of photon with the matter. Photons interact differently in the matter than the charged particles because photons have no electrical charge. And in contrast to charged particles, photons do not continuously lose energy when they travel through the matter, whereas charged particles lose continuously their energy. The interactions of photon with the matter is probabilistic, while the interaction of charged particle is certain. There may be case when the photon does not interact at all with the matter, but if it is charged particle, it will certainly interact with the atom or the matter. Therefore, the interaction of photon becomes a complex interaction, and there are 9 possible interactions, which will include photoelectric effect, Compton scattering, air production, Rayleigh scattering, and later on the slides we will be having a discussion on Thomson scattering and photonuclear reactions. But these 4 are of significance, whereas there are 9 possible interactions of photon with the matter. Let's see one by one what is photoelectric effect. In the photoelectric effect, when there is interaction of incident photon with the inner shell orbit, and the entire energy of the incident photon is transferred to the orbital electron, and the orbital electron gets such energy which is sufficient enough to overcome its binding energy and have some energy as a kinetic energy to come out from its orbital, then it is called as a photoelectric effect. And the electron which comes out from the orbit is called as a photoelectron, and the energy of this photoelectron is equal to energy of incident photon minus the binding energy of that particular electron in that shell. So the photoelectric effect looks like a collision between photon and an orbital electron, in which the electron is ejected from the atom and the photon disappears. In case of Compton scattering, which is also called as an incoherent scattering, there is an interaction of incident photon with the generally outer shell orbit of the atom, and the part of energy is transferred to the orbital electron, and the rest of the energy is carried away by the photon which was incident, and now this photon is called as a scattered photon. And the orbital electron which comes out from the orbit is called as a Compton recoil electron. And the energy of this scattered photon is calculated as per this formula, whereas the energy of recoil electron is the difference between energies of incident photon and the scattered photon. And this Compton scattering is a collision between photon and a loosely bound outer shell orbital electron of an atom. In case of pair production, when there is an interaction of photon with the nucleus of the atom, and energy of incident photon is sufficiently high, which means if it is a more than 1.022 MeV, it interacts with the nucleus and energy is converted into the mass of a pair of electrons and positron. That is why it is called as a pair production, where electron and positron pairs are created. The rest mass energy of positron and electron is 511 keV. So therefore, 511 keV plus 511 keV, that is 1022 keV energy of minimum is required to take place a pair production. And whatever excess energy is carried by the incident photon, that is distributed as a kinetic energy among electron and the positron. And this distribution of energies as a kinetic is a random phenomenon. Eventually, this positron interacts with the other orbital electron, and annihilation reaction takes place, where 2 gamma photons of 511 keV comes out during this process. And in case of Rayleigh scattering, see the property of photon. It carries a magnetic vector as well as electrical vector, and the intersection of these 2 planes are defined as trajectory of the photon. This electrical field causes oscillation of this orbital electron, and when this orbital electron comes to the ground state, this releases some form of electromagnetic radiation. So when the low energy of photons, the electrical field of passing photons causes electrons of an atom to oscillate. See, when there is a high energy, there is probability of Compton scattering taking place, but when there is a energy is low and it cannot overcome the binding energy of the orbital electron, then there is chances of Rayleigh scattering taking place, and these vibrating electrons emit their own electromagnetic radiation and return to their original undisturbed state. And the electromagnetic emissions of atom's electron leaves in a direction different from that of incident photon. And in case of Thomson scattering, everything is same only if there is a single free electron is involved rather than all the electrons as in the Rayleigh scattering. This is also a coherent scattering, and the original photon disappears and a new photon of the same energy is emitted in the different directions. In case of photonuclear reactions, there is an interaction of photon with the nucleus of the atom, and the photon is absorbed by the nucleus, and a nuclear particle, that is neutron, proton and alpha, may be ejected. And the extreme example of this may be photon induced fission, whereas the common example is photoneutron reactions. For these reactions to occur, the photon energy must exceed the binding energy of the particle, and usually this threshold energy is on the order of 7 to 15 MeV, that is million electron volts. However, there may be some exceptions. So these all are different interactions of photons with the matter. To summarize all these, there are two kinds of radiation, particulate radiation and the electromagnetic radiation. Particulate radiation interacts with the matter in the mechanism of excitation, ionization and Bremsstrahlung, and electromagnetic radiations interact with the matter in the mechanism of photoelectric effect, Compton scattering, pair production, Rayleigh scattering, Thomson scattering, photonuclear reactions like that. In the next presentation, we are going to discuss about gas fill detectors, and in gas fill detectors, we are going to discuss about ionization chamber based detectors, which includes dose calibrators, gun monitor, and the pocket dosimeter. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. Please feel free to write us at support@nuclearmedicinesolutions.in for any feedback or query. Thank you very much.